There are several things I want to make the members and friends of the Church of Columbus aware of, but I'd like to begin by sharing a paraphrased quote from the writings of Thomas Paine, a major influence in America's break from England in the 1700s. These are the times that try men's souls. The summer Christian and the sunshine servant of God will, in this crisis, shrink from his service. But he that stands by him now deserves the love and thanks of every Christian who follows that example. The tyranny of a pandemic like hell is not easily conquered. Yet we have this consolation with us, that the harder the conflict, the more glorious the triumph. What we obtain too cheaply, we esteem too lightly. It is a dearness only that gives everything its value. Heaven knows how to put a proper price upon its goods, and it would be strange indeed if so celestial an article as freedom from fear and absolute faith in God should not be highly rated. Many thanks to the singers, musicians, sound, video, computer, information teams, minister, staff, our housekeeper, our grounds crew, and all of our faithful saints for the ongoing care of our facility and for their help in continuing to make these online videos possible. Thanks to their dedication and commitment to the work of God, we're able to bring you these sermons and lessons and Sunday school lessons and other information and updates through the Church of Columbus website every week. Within about 36 hours after the mayor of Columbus issued the first declaration of emergency, this dedicated group of brothers and sisters had prepared to post our first online church service. And each church service thereafter, they've been making improvements in the process that brings these services to our members and to the friends of the Church of Columbus. I want to say also that I'm very proud in the Holy Ghost of the spiritual maturity being demonstrated by the faithful saints of the church. You're reaching out to one another to stay in touch and to encourage one another to stand strong in the faith. You're reminding your brothers and sisters that all things work together for good to them that love God. You're extending offers to assist our elderly saints in the event they have a need. You're praying that God uses this pandemic to remind the world of their need for a Savior, and for this unprecedented experience will draw them to Jesus Christ. While some folks feel that it's unnecessary to give while the sanctuary doors are closed, you understand that we give to God because that's just what faithful, mature Christians who love the Lord do. We're faithful stewards of God's blessing. The ministers of the Church of Columbus will join together in united prayer to anoint special prayer cloths for those who request them. These prayer cloths are not made of magic material or miraculous material. It's just plain old earthly material. But the difference is it allows you a point of contact and a reminder that the ministers of the church and staff are praying for you during this difficult time. I've asked Sister Richards to gather a small group of our ladies also to pray over these prayer cloths and to send them to everyone who contacts her with their physical mailing address. By faith, this will be done during the month of April. Again, you'll need to send Sister Richards your physical mailing address. Her email and text information can be found on the church's website under the tab About Us, then scroll down to Ministers. On Wednesday, April 1st, this is not an April Fool's joke, the mayor of Columbus extended the declaration of emergency to include the entire month of April. So we cannot by law gather with more than 10 people. As we've explained in previous videos, Christians are among the most law-abiding citizens in the country. As long as we're not forbidden to preach and teach God's word, we'll certainly abide by the law. We are very conscientious of the welfare of others. That's just the spiritual nature of a child of God, caring for others. We'll do our part to be safe and to be conscientious of the safety and welfare of our neighbors. We do our best here at the Church of Columbus to keep everything updated daily on our church's website, so please keep an eye on it. Should you have questions for the pastor or any of the ministers, you're welcome to contact us via email. Go to the tab, About Us, scroll down to Ministers, and our email addresses are there. I want to encourage you to watch the videos of recent sermons and Bible studies, as well as Sunday school lessons for children that have been posted on the church's website. These lessons and sermons are proving to be providential. Believe me when I tell you, you will never sit in a church service with Bible ministry more prophetic than the studies taught just 4 months ago on three lessons on faith, and just 2 months ago when the theme sermon was preached entitled Smooth Stones. I felt in my spirit while these were being ministered here at the church that God's people were about to experience a life-altering challenge that would be spiritually transformative. You need to see these videos. As we know, Easter is next Sunday. This is the first time in the 67-year history of the Church of Columbus that we will not be gathering in the sanctuary for an Easter service. However, we will post an announcement on the church's website next Saturday to let you know if we will be having a parking lot service on Sunday. If it's raining, we'll post our Easter service on the church's website as we do on Sunday at noon. What is a parking lot service? It's a church service in the parking lot. So come early for a good spot. If it's raining, if we can't have the service, we should know that by Saturday. So again, please keep an eye on the church's website to stay up to date on any information regarding the church.
The whole. seek your praise. The whole earth seeks your praise. You are holy. You are holy. The whole earth seeks your praise. The whole earth seeks your praise.
Praise the Lord, everyone. Here are a few announcements this morning. Just a reminder to visit the Church of Columbus website often. We are posting Pastor Shepherd's sermons that will minister to us during these difficult times. Some of these sermons are prophetic and warnings that have helped prepare the church for this crisis. Just a reminder that if the City of Columbus declaration of emergency continues past April 3rd, the church website will be updated concerning church services. We will continue to post pastor's sermons on video. Please encourage your friends to watch the sermons and feel free to post them on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, or any other form of social media. And to all faithful members of the church, please remember that there are three ways to continue your faithful stewardship. Click on the green tab in the center of the church webpage for instructions for giving. Click on the giving tab on the top right of the page to use PayPal. And you are welcome to mail a check to the Church of Columbus P.O. Box listed on the right side of the webpage. Be encouraged, church. Keep your head up and continue praising the Lord.
Heal all.
Good morning, everyone. We're going to go to the Lord in prayer. But before we do, we have several prayer requests that we need to remember throughout the remainder of this week. We need to remember Linda Brown. She has health concerns. Dan Spears Sr., he's been diagnosed with lung cancer. We need to remember Brother Reynolds' daughter, Jewel, because she has cancerous tumors. We need to remember Daryl Sims and Gary Wolf. They both need total healing in their body. And also, we need to remember our local healthcare workers and physicians during this time of the pandemic. The Bible tells us in the Old Testament writings of Isaiah, chapter 25, verse 4, we find the prophet making a weighty statement about God, stating, "For thou hast been a strength to the poor, a strength to the needy in his distress, a refuge from the storm and a shadow from the heat." This scripture lets you know that struggles in this life are real, and they come in many forms of difficulties and strength, which are often unexpected and indeed unwanted. But there is one thing for sure. Trouble will either keep you down or it will cause you to rise up to its challenges and allow it to make you stronger. 2 Corinthians 4 verses 8 and 9 tells us that though we are troubled on every side, yet we are not distressed, perplexed but not in despair, persecuted but not forsaken, cast down but not destroyed. These passages tell us that God is bigger and more powerful than any obstacle you may face. And I want you to know this morning that we are on the winning side of things. Shall we go to the Lord in prayer and ask Him to touch you in your present circumstances and watch Him do the impossible? If you're near a monitor, I want you to stretch forth your hands in agreement and pray with me. Lord, we come boldly before your throne this morning, and we ask that you release the sword of your word against our adversaries and bring every enemy into captivity. Lord, we ask that you would touch those that have financial lack or personal unbelief, and we come against it. Fear and uncertainty, you are bound in Jesus' name. We pray that you baptize each of us with the fire of your word and the power of the Holy Ghost. Let your presence flood our minds and remove all reluctance in your ability to invade the impossible. We ask that you let your anointing give us boldness, and may your fire be in our hands as we lay hands on the sick, healing those afflicted with cancers and sickness. Lord, we also ask that you provide us with opportunities with the lost and to see the miraculous take place everywhere we go. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
Oh, God.
Praise the Lord. It's good to have you with us on this Sunday afternoon. I want to preach to you for a little while on this topic. Let thy faith fail not. Luke chapter 22, verse 31 says this, and the Lord said, Simon, Simon, behold, Satan hath desired to have you, that he may sift you as wheat. But I have prayed for thee, that thy faith fail not. And when thou art converted, strengthen thy brethren. What is faith? The simplest, most direct answer is persuasion. Faith is persuasion. Faith is being persuaded or convinced of something. Faith in God is this: I am persuaded that God exists. I am persuaded that he lives in my heart. I am persuaded that he is everything his word says he is. I am persuaded that nothing shall be able to separate me from his love. I am persuaded that nothing will happen in my life that God does not allow to happen. I am persuaded by his word. I am persuaded by my personal experience of the infilling of the Holy Ghost. I am persuaded by the keeping power of the Lord in my life. I am persuaded by when I pray in the Holy Ghost and he builds up my faith. I am persuaded by the trial of my faith that builds my faith. And I am persuaded that by the Rhema word of God that builds and renews my faith every time I hear it. Jesus told Peter, I have prayed for thee that thy faith fail not. Why would Jesus Christ himself pray for this apostle? Because Peter's faith, had it failed, would have meant that his apostleship would have been taken away. His relationship with Jesus would have been nullified. His walking on water, watching Jesus levitate above the ground while meeting Moses and Elijah, his witnessing the many miracles performed by the Lord would have all been wasted on this faithless failure. His Pentecost sermon would never have been preached. So Peter's faith had to remain intact. It was an eternal imperative. Jesus had to pray for Peter's faith not to fail, because losing his faith would have had eternal consequences. Too many souls depended on Peter remaining steadfast, committed, and true to the cause of Christ. So Jesus told Peter, Satan hath desired to have you, to sift you as wheat. He wants to put you through the wringer. He wants to see what you're made of. He wants to know just how committed you really are. But I have prayed for thee that thy faith fail not. Jesus didn't say, I prayed that Satan will leave you alone. He said, I prayed that your faith doesn't fail. God's people will be tested. But as long as our faith remains securely anchored in him, the church will pass every test. Jesus prayed that Peter's love for his Savior would be so strong that it would secure their spiritual bond so that his faith would not fail. Think about it. He spoke a word and light suddenly appeared. It pushed back the darkness and shined brightly upon an earth that had been living under Satan's gloomy veil for untold eons. He spoke again, and dry land rose up miraculously out of the depths of the waters. Trees popped up out of the ground, and jungles grew lush and green. Another word was spoken, and a universe so vast was immediately formed that its enormity is incomprehensible. Students of the stars now tell us that there are 2 trillion galaxies in the universe and at least 1 trillion stars in every galaxy. Horses and cows, giraffes and elephants, bumblebees and butterflies began to fill the earth with sounds of new life. Birds with wings that still drip with the watery afterbirth of the ocean's womb took flight and built nests in newly formed trees. Scientists are still examining the complex biology of our diverse planet. Astronomers are still trying to measure the expanse of a universe that seems to go on and on forever. And our God created it all with a word. So when Jesus Christ, the God-man, God manifested in flesh, said to the Apostle Peter, "But I have prayed for thee that thy faith fail not." What does that tell us about the enormous, incredible need for us to pray for one another during these times that try men's souls? What does that tell us about the vital importance of praying for our brothers and sisters so that our faith fail not? The prayer of Jesus Christ had the power of creation behind it. This was no common man praying for common things. This was Jesus the Messiah, the Lamb of God that taketh away the sins of the world, the Savior of the souls of men, who is interceding for the Apostle Peter. With divine influence, the powers of heaven behind him, Jesus prayed a prayer that reached into the dynamo of God's spiritual enablement. Jesus prayed beyond the frailty of human flesh, through the darkness of a night filled with anxiety and uncertainty, and connected with a spiritual power that the stumbling apostle would need to get him through his trial and stabilize his trust in God. What were the results of the prayer that Jesus prayed? Peter's faith did not fail. And we, the church of the living God, the body of Christ, who are filled with the Holy Spirit, have within the realm of our influence the privilege of calling on the name of the Lord Jesus to petition him on behalf of our brothers and sisters in Christ, to move God to strengthen them in their resolve so that their faith does not fail. There's no substitute for prayer. The time we spend in the temporary solitude of a prayer closet could mean the difference between saving or losing a brother or sister in the Lord, or reaching a sinner who needs salvation. Now, I'm not talking about reactive prayer that is the result of a crisis. I'm talking about proactive prayer that deals with a crisis before it ever reaches the crisis stage. I'm talking to you about praying in a way that you are praying to God, and God is speaking to you, and you are speaking to God, and a God that can transform you and can transform those for whom you pray. When Jesus preached the Sermon on the Mount, he explained how personal prayer was intended to work. When thou prayest, according to Matthew chapter 6, thou shalt not be as the hypocrites are, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and in the corners of the streets, that they may be seen of men. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. But thou, when thou prayest, enter into thy closet. The word closet from the original Greek means bedchamber. And when thou hast shut the door, pray to thy Father, which is in secret. And thy Father, which seeth in secret, shall reward thee openly. Jesus likened a personal prayer closet or chamber or space to a bedroom. Those who heard him teaching understood the analogy that he used. A bedchamber is a confidential, private, personal place where husband and wife share their most intimate feelings. A place where there are no pretenses, there are no concealed secrets, there are no suspicions. A bedchamber is a place of tenderness, of warmth, of passion and honesty. And it's this kind of place that Jesus said is the perfect place to commune with God. A prayer closet is where you lay all of life's worries and concerns and anxieties aside. You turn off the telephone. You lock the door. you postpone your appointments, unplug the vacuum cleaner, put the baby down for a nap, and focus solely, completely, absolutely on the lover of your soul. Jude wrote in verse 20, building up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. This is the kind of prayer that preempts the panic of a pandemic, the consternation of a crisis. This is the kind of prayer that prepares a child of God for every potential problem. This is the kind of prayer that bolsters an apostle Peter and stabilizes his faith to withstand the onslaught of Satan's demonic soldiers, evil spirits that would try to derail his destiny as the preacher of Pentecost, the preacher who would introduce the world to the salvation power of the Holy Ghost. Peter's faith had to withstand almost immediate testing, the trial of the fiery darts, the humiliating act of denial, the crowing of the rooster, the shame that kept him in the shadows of the city wall while he watched his Savior dying on Calvary's cross. Within earshot of the Lord's cries of, "My Father, why hast thou forsaken me?" He could have taken the easy way out. He could have followed the example of a traitorous Judas. But Peter's faith kept him hanging on, because Jesus Christ himself had called his name in prayer. How many of our brothers and sisters in the Lord, how many men, women, young people, whose dedication and commitment are being assaulted by Satan right now? How many are in desperate need of our prayers? In the midst of this worldwide pandemic that holds mankind in its ever-tightening grip of fear, believe me when I tell you, you must find a bedchamber of prayer and commune with God in such a way that enables his awesome transformative power to be released to push back the forces of darkness, to solidify the faith of your fellow Christians, to draw sinners to Calvary and compel men to seek his face. If we fail to pray, we will be failing our own brothers and sisters. If we fail to pray, we will be throwing lost souls to the hungry hounds of hell. If we fail to pray, Satan will win. The pandemic will take its toll, and souls around the world will have paid the price for our lukewarm timidity in the face of Goliath-like challenge. But if we pray, we will invoke the powers of a God that spoke worlds into existence and spanned the heavens with his hand. If we pray, we will unleash a divine force so overwhelming that nothing will be able to stand in its path. If we pray, we will untie God's hands to do what only God can do. If we pray, the faith of God's church will not fail. It will be bolstered. It will withstand the doubts of men, the threats of financial collapse, the menace of a deadly virus, the paralyzing fear that grips the world, and it will defeat every dastardly weapon in the devil's arsenal. So pray, pray for your brothers, pray for your sisters, that their faith fail not. Pray for God to touch and comfort those trembling, hurting souls who are terrorized by illness that man has yet to find a cure for, a virus that only the hand of God has a right now cure for. If Jesus found it necessary to pray that the faith of his own apostle would be sustained, then we must pray that the faith of our brothers and sisters endures the challenging time of extraordinary testing that we are living in, this time that tries men's faith. Let's pray. Precious Lord, you are a faithful God. You are majestic, glorious, high and lifted up. Heaven is your starry throne room and earth is your lowly footstool. The clouds in the sky are your stepping stones, and we, O God, are your children. Through the telescope of time, every minute of every hour of earth's horrendous malady was in your view before man ever made the first human footprint in Eden. But Lord, in this treacherous time, Men must traverse a world where unseen landmines laid out by this pandemic have been hidden. Many are apprehensive during every moment of their lives, terrified of the invisible vestiges of a potentially deadly virus that might linger in the very air they breathe. But you are an all-seeing God. So order our steps and guide us as we go. Turn the eyes and hearts of those who need a gentle shepherd toward you during these desperate days. Lord, we understand that you are the way, the truth, and the life. I pray that souls would look to you for salvation and healing and eternal life during this worldwide calamity that has caused panic and fear to permeate every aspect of human life. While the human heart is tender, while the human spirit is receptive, while men, women, and young people in a hurry have been slowed down and adjusted the volume of their spiritual hearing, speak to them your life-giving word. While fear of personal proximity has driven them away from one another, draw them close to you. Hear their repentant prayers. Fill them with your spirit and give them the assurance that you give to all of your children, that all things work together for good to them that love God. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, amen.
Love you, Jesus. Bring me back praise to you. And lift you up.
my